Good evening, everybody. How's everybody doing? This is Andy Reber here with Orlando Orthopaedic Center. I'm just going to wait here another minute or two to allow everybody to log in that registered for tonight's webinar. I appreciate you guys joining in with us. We're going to hang on here for just a minute or two to let everybody else join, and then we will start the presentation.
I gotta be proud, standing out in the crowd with the odds in the game by you. Try your best to win them all, and one day time will tell. When you're the one left standing there, you've reached the final bell. You're the best around. Nothing's gonna ever keep you down. You're the best around. Nothing's gonna ever keep you down. You're the best around. Nothing's gonna ever keep you down. History repeats itself. Try and you succeed. Never doubt that you're the one, and you can have your dream. You're the best around. Nothing's gonna ever keep you down. You're the best around. And nothing's gonna ever keep you down. You're the best around. Nothing's gonna ever keep you down.
All right, everybody, welcome, 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 welcome to all families, athletes, coaches, directors, administrators of FKK. Thank you guys so much for tuning into our care and prevention, the 2022 care and prevention webinar. My name is Andy Reber. I'm with Orlando Orthopaedic Center, and we have a really special presentation for you. We've done this the last few years. Last year, we did a Facebook Live Q&A. Prior to that, we've done some live presentations for all the families and the kids at some high schools and churches. So this year we wanted to change it up, just try something a little bit different. So I know it's a school night, busy night for everybody. So thanks for tuning in. We hopefully won't take up too much of your time. Before we do get going, I just have a few housekeeping items. And before I introduce our panelists, the first thing is I want to announce something very exciting. Again, I think this was blasted out to you guys internally, but the Orlando Orthopaedic Center Foundation we'll be awarding three $250 scholarships for any of those that are watching this evening. They will be randomly selected at the conclusion of the presentation tonight by the FKK administrators. They'll be randomly selected. Again, the Orlando Orthopaedic Center Foundation will be awarding three $250 scholarships that can go to registration fees, or equipment or things of that nature. But you have to be attending and viewing this webinar this evening. Okay, so moving on, first things first, questions and answers. We really, really appreciate any engagement from those that are watching this evening. On the bottom of your screen, there should be a Q&A icon. What you do is you click on that Q&A icon and then please legibly type a question that you have for our panelists. Try to stay out of the chat. I may put a website or something in there. I don't like flooding the chat room. So let's just keep it to the Q&A icon. If you do have a question, direct it to somebody specifically, to a certain panelist or to anybody, it doesn't really matter. And what we'll do is when we're all done with all the presentations, I'll ask those questions to the panelists, okay? So without further ado, I would like to introduce all of our speakers. Our first speaker, all of you know probably very, very well, is Danny Sposato. Danny is the Director of Education at Spectrum and is the Performance Director for all of you with FKK. Danny received his BS in Exercise Science at UCF. Then our second presenter is going to be Brendan Abbey. Brendan Abbey is an athletic trainer and he's currently the Sports Medicine Outreach Coordinator at Orlando Orthopaedic Center. He received his BS in athletic training at UCF, and he received his MS in exercise physiology at McNeese State in Louisiana, where he also served as the men's basketball athletic trainer. And then he spent 7 years as the men's basketball athletic trainer at Bucknell prior to OOC. Then our next presenter will be Tom Hines. Tom is a physician assistant at Orlando Orthopaedic Center, primarily treating patients at the OOC Orthopaedic Injury Walking Clinics. Prior to that, Tom was also a PA at Florida Orthopaedic Institute. and also served as an athletic trainer with Cora here in town. He received his BS in athletic training at UCF, and he received his Master of Physician Assistant Studies at UF. We also hopefully have two very special guests. Hopefully they're logging in to join us in the Q&A session at the end, one of them being Allie Long, who's the midfielder of Gotham FC in the National Women's Soccer League, where she played prior at Penn State and transferring to UNC for her college experience. And then Dax McCarty. Dax was a midfielder for the Nashville Soccer Club in Major League Soccer. He played college soccer in UNC, and he was raised right here centrally in the Winter Park area. Again, hopefully they can join us at the end for some question and answers. So without further ado, I'm going to have Danny join in to start the presentation. He'll also be returning to talk about some return to play activities for any sports injuries. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen, and I'll let Danny come on stage.
Hey, Andy, thanks for introducing me. Seeing my screen all right?
Yep, we're good, Dan.
Awesome. So I kind of want to take a minute and kind of talk what we expect here at Spectrum as the performance staff for FKK. We essentially have two jobs as your staff. First one is to reduce the chance of injury, and the second one is to improve performance on the field. Those are our two assignments, and in that order specifically. Everything that our athletes are doing in the facility is geared towards those two goals. For as long as we're going to be with this club, that's always going to be our main initiative. So we're going to kind of start talking about what to expect from a Spectrum session. Obviously, we do a fall semester, and then we go into the spring. I kind of have the cliff notes here up on the screen for you guys to look at of everything that happens within a session, and I'll kind of dig a little bit deeper into all of them. But right off the jump, we want to expose these athletes to max effort, jumping and sprinting, essentially maximal effort plyometric work. It's so important to kind of keep in mind, like, if we're going to prevent athletes from injury, the one of the best ways we can do that is to prepare them for all the things that could and can happen to them on the field. And we do it in this building in a controlled environment where we're making small changes to their biomechanics and things like that, so that they're ready for it when they experience it on the field. And one of the things, like we just talked about, is a maximal effort plyometric activity. So much of soccer is a lot of short sprint, stop, change direction, oh, got to go a different direction. And it's a lot of short sprints and things like that, and like high impact on these athletes' ankles, knees, and hips. And so in the facility, we want to, like I said, expose them to that and teach them the proper way to do things. It's super common some of our athletes land with their knees caving in, or when they run, they stride a little bit too long, and that puts a lot of stress on the hamstring. The athletes who land with their knees caving in, it's a lot of stress on the knees and on the ankles. And so if we can, in this building, teach proper landing mechanisms, and when we say proper, essentially it's the way to do it that is going to prevent the least amount of impact and be the most efficient way so that performance is there, so that when they're on the field, when they're playing, when they're practicing, they're doing things the right way. When they're doing things the right way, we're reducing their chance of overuse injuries. So every session, once we get past the warm-up, we go into some sort of a like power block, essentially. Things that can be in these blocks are, in the beginning, it's a lot of just simple jumping and landing, bilateral, unilateral, we're going forward, we're going side to side, we're going rotational. And then some kind of sprint work, something typically that is technical in nature, whether it's resisted sprint, whether it is some kind of like wall drill, and then we're going into actual sprints, and we're putting the body under those stressors, essentially. Like I said, if we prepare them for what they're going to do, it's going to prevent their chance of having an injury on the field. Right off the jump, we talk about like maximal effort sprinting. If their hamstrings, their hip flexors are not used to those activities, and then for whatever reason, they have a long ball on the field and they got a chase ball down 20, 30 yards, like that's an athlete who's set up for some kind of issue. And so that's the biggest reason, like I said, we're gonna introduce it. And then the flip side, our second goal is to improve performance. If we practice jumping, if we practice sprinting, our body gets better at it. Athletes become more powerful, athletes become faster, which is really important, obviously, to their performance on the field. typically, as you look at most models, as in when an athlete goes from off season to preseason to in season, by the end of that season, their physical attributes typically have gotten worse. They're typically slower and less powerful because they've been beat up from the season. And so them coming in once a week with us and exposing them to max effort speed, max effort jumping, allows us to maintain a lot of those physical attributes. And our goal is honestly to create improvement, and a lot, especially with the younger athletes. And so that's kind of right up the jump, the power block, the exposure to max effort plyometric work. From there, we'll transition into a strength block. Essentially, we want to build muscular integrity throughout the entire body. It's very simple. If our muscles are stronger, if our muscles are more conditioned, they take a lot of the impact off of the joints. They become more durable. And they're going to be able to handle the stressor of 3-4 practices a week, 1 or 2 games on the weekends, not getting the most amount of recovery possible, and, you know, having to go back into it for a 9-week period in the spring, a 13-14 week period. Things that we're going to be doing in these strength sessions are always, one, catered to the ability level of the athlete. And I'll kind of get more into that at the end, how the session changes based on the age group. But a lot of times it's unilateral in nature. We're trying to build single leg stability. We're trying to build quads and glutes and hamstrings and muscles throughout the shin and the calf and upper body as well. The other thing that I put in here, and some of the other panelists can attest to this, like one of the biggest preventers of a knee injury is the ratio of hamstring strength to quad. In soccer, it's so much short sprints, which is typically a quad-based movement. Athletes have really developed quads, right? Quads and hip flexors. The problem is when we're not doing the back end, we're not training the hamstrings, the gap between strength of the quad, the anterior muscles, compared to posterior hamstrings and glutes, as that gets bigger, our athletes are more likely of some kind of knee injury. And so in these sessions, we will always do 2 hamstring exercises for every 1 quad exercise we're doing, because we're trying to even that ratio out as best we can, like I said, to make the athletes more durable. But they're going to hit every muscle tissue, every muscle part when they come in for these sessions. We're typically doing at most 2 exercises per muscle group, because we understand these athletes are in season. They need to be able to practice. They need to be able to play. And so if they're crushed, that's a problem. And so as a result, they're not getting a whole lot of volume. We're doing things right. We're making sure they're doing them the safest possible way. And it's catered, like I said, towards the ability level of the athlete. And then kind of typically that final block within a session is going to be some variety of prehab exercises, specifically hip, knee, ankle. We know these are the common injury locations for soccer players. And so as a result, like, we want to be proactive in all of these areas. And so different things, low level training, isometric activities throughout all of these muscle groups, or all the muscles around surrounding these joints, essentially. And it kind of goes back to what we said with the whole body strength. Like, if we make these muscles more developed, they become more durable, they take more of the load off of the actual joint, the ligament itself, they start to handle things, and these athletes just become more durable as they go out, or as they go through, like, really grueling seasons. And so those are essentially the 3 parts of what a spectrum session looks like. In the beginning, we go, like I said, we do 9 weeks in the fall, we do 13 in the spring. When the athletes come to us the first couple of weeks, it's a lot of teaching. It's a lot of learning the things that we're going to build on throughout the semester. And then as we kind of get later in, we start adding a little bit more load, doing things a little bit faster. And then typically when we get to the end of the semester, we're coinciding with them either being in their most competitive phase, like they are in the spring, or the end of the fall, they're getting ready to go into high school. And so we need to kind of start reducing a lot of the volume so that they're feeling fresh, they're feeling fast. So they go into high school healthy, knowing that high school is going to be kind of tough on them. And then one last thing I kind of want to talk about is how it differs amongst the age groups. So obviously the U18s, U17s are doing very different things compared to like the U13s. We essentially look at athletes based on how many years have they been in a training environment, right? So for example, our youngest age group, the 09 and the 10, or in the 10s, when they come in, we are under the understanding that they've never been in a training environment. They're brand new to all of these things. And so as a result, the exercises they're doing are, one, resistance is minimal. It's essentially used as a teaching tool. There are certain movements that you will get better at by having a little bit of resistance, even in something as simple as a 5 or 10 pound dumbbell. And it's teaching the basic movements, the squat, the hinge, how to use their core, develop glutes, upper body pushing and pulling, real basic stuff that's done repetitively. And it's very practice in nature. Let's do things right. Let's do them over and over again. And then as athletes kind of get a little bit older, we start dealing with like the 08s, 07s, 06s. We can start introducing some of the bigger movements, but again, only because they've already learned them when they were in their earlier phases. Resistance is still really low, especially for the 08s, but it's, let's introduce a barbell in certain things when appropriate. Like I said, continue to build on the patterns they've all developed. And then as we get to the older age group, which is now 04, 05s, it's understanding a lot of these kids are getting ready, you know, to eventually play collegiately. And so it's, let's prepare them and do some of the movements that they're going to be doing in a college weight room so that when they get there, they're ready for it. And so a lot of different movements, a lot of different, we do 4 hours of training, and every hour the session looks totally different based on the age that essentially is coming in. And so it's kind of important to keep that in mind, like this resistance training only works if it's progressive and if it's appropriate to the age group that's coming in the building. So that's kind of an idea of what to expect from our SSP sessions that the athletes are doing once a week as they go out the season. So I'm going to go ahead and toss it back.
Thanks. Thanks, Danny. Well, and just a reminder to everybody that's watching, some more people are tuning in here. If you guys have a question, I highly encourage you guys to write some questions. Just go in that Q&A icon at the bottom of your screen and type in the question that you have for any of our panelists, and we'll do that at the end. Our next presenter is going to be Brendan. If Brendan can go ahead and turn on the screen and log in. Brendan's going to talk to you guys a little bit about what to expect with on the field athletic training coverage and evaluation when a sports injury occurs. Our Orlando Orthopaedic Center, we provide many of the athletic trainers on the field for you guys, and Brendan being one of them, and he's going to talk to you a little bit about Orlando Orthopaedic Center and what to expect. So go ahead, Brendan, take it away.
All right. First, I just wanted to reiterate what Danny said, how important it is to strength train for preventative purposes. Your muscles are like shock absorbers on a car. So the stronger you can get through Danny and Spectrum, the less likely you are to hurt yourself out on the field. And first thing, I want to just take you to your all's website at Florida Kraze Krush here. And if you can see, there's two different links, one here for Orlando Orthopaedic Center and one right here. And if you just click on those links, it'll take you to a great sports medicine resource. That'll give you a lot of information of our locations and different things. But as you guys know, as you're practicing and playing, there's an athletic trainer usually central to all your fields. And if someone gets hurt, you're going to hear one of your coaches scream out, "Trainer!" And usually the athletic trainer will jog over to the field, and we'll be watching and observing. That's the primary thing, is we're just going to do a primary survey of the area of how you're presenting yourself injured and how serious or severe the injury is going to be. So kind of referring to this medical action plan on the website, the number one thing we're going to want to do is determine if it's a medical emergency or a non-medical emergency. So some examples of a medical emergency would be head or neck injury, if you lose consciousness, if you have a dislocated joint or fractured bones, any kind of eye or tooth injury, allergic reaction, severe asthma attack, heat stroke, extreme bleeding. And so in that situation, we're gonna just try and stabilize and triage as best we can and get 911 called and get them to the scene and activate and call your parents if they are there, or at least let them know what's going on. If an athletic trainer is on the field, they'll be the first there. It's going to be the best and safest option for all parties involved. And they're going to ask you what happened. So let's say it's a non-emergency. You might have hurt your knee or your hamstring, as Danny was talking about. And the athletic trainer is going to typically ask you what happened, because the more information they can gather from you about how you hurt yourself, the history of your injury, it's going to give them a better way to evaluate you and see if you can return playing or if you should sit out for a while or seek further medical care. Once they have a good idea of what's going on, they're probably going to just kind of look at your body, look at the injury site. Let's say it's a knee, and they'll kind of touch your knee, see where it's point tender or if you have a lot of swelling or bruising, and just determine what they think. They'll decide whether to take you off the field. If it's safe to transport you off the field, we'll take you off the field. That way everyone else can get back to playing and do a little more thorough of an evaluation. And that's where they might do some special tests to determine if they can just tape you up, or maybe you just have a little light blood, and tape you, stop the bleeding, get you back in the game, get you playing, or if it's most beneficial, take you out of the game and stop you for a while. If you do have an injury, again, you can come to this webpage the next day, and here, if you see priority scheduling, you can click right on this, and you and your parent can enter in when you had the injury, athlete's name, guardian's name, phone number, email, date of birth, and this will get you into the system right away, so you can come to one of the Orlando Orthopaedic clinics and get evaluated by a PA or a doctor to go forward from there and get you back in the game as fast as possible. Obviously, we want you guys to compete at your highest level and play as much as you can safely and healthily. And with that, I will turn it over to Tom so he can tell you more
One second, Brendan. So if you guys look, I just put that link. That link has been up there for a while on the website, but I just typed it in there into the chat room as well, OrlandoOrtho.com/FKK. And as Brendan mentioned, that's your specialized link for your club. So as he went through that with the scheduling, you can type in that information, you press send, and that'll come to myself or priority scheduler Brendan. And then what we can do is help you get into one of the clinics as soon as possible. But please, I encourage everybody to really check out this website. Everything that there is to know on there, I encourage the coaches and directors and staff to push that out as much as possible to you guys. Our job is we want to get you seen on the field, but try to give you the best resources as possible and get you seen as quickly as we can. So there's also some great educational stuff in there. Some stuff previously from the other conferences, seminars that we've done. There's video. Brendan mentioned all our locations, our walk-ins. And then there's always a question about insurance. Right, Brendan, that question always comes up. So there's a list of our insurance on the very bottom of that website. And you can click it on and see all of our accepted insurances. And sometimes we'll update this website as we need to, as an orthopedic group, because some of this stuff changes. So again, feel free if you guys have any questions about any of that kind of stuff, you can let us know. So, all right, Brendan, thank you very much. Now moving on, we're going to bring on Mr. Tom Hines. As I mentioned before, Tom is a physician assistant at Orlando Orthopaedic Center. And Tom's going to talk to you a little bit about what to expect in the clinic for sports injury when you come to Orlando Orthopaedic Center, what's expected during that clinic time with one of our providers. So, Tom, if you can go ahead and turn yourself on there.
All right. Good afternoon. Again, my name's Tom Hines. I'm one of the physician assistants at the Orlando Orthopaedic Center. I thank you guys for all participating in this educational webinar. I want to talk to you guys about what Orlando Orthopaedic Center can do to help support your athlete throughout the season. Let me start sharing my screen here. There we go. Reber, can you see my screen?
We see you, but cannot see the screen.
All right. What about now?
Yep. Just go on to...
Is that better?
Open up. Yep, there you go, Tom.
Perfect. All right. So just to recap, we all know that everybody participating in this webinar today is part of FKK, one of the greatest soccer organizations known to produce elite athletes. We all know that you guys train with Spectrum, which is known to increase your athleticism and put your athlete to the next level. But what if your athlete sustains an injury on the field? Well, I'll tell you one thing. One of the Orlando Orthopaedic Center walk-in clinic, our athletic trainers will be able to perform an on-field evaluation of your athlete and determine the severity of the injury. Is it something that just needs ice and time and rest with over-the-counter analgesics, or is it something more severe that would require a higher level of care? So when it does require a higher level of care, what's the next step? Well, that's where Orlando Orthopaedic Center comes into place. We've been serving the public over 50 years for their orthopedic needs. So we have 5 convenient located walk-in clinics throughout Orange and Seminole County, and we're open Monday through Saturday. Our clinics go all the way north at Castleberry and then can go all the way south to Lake Nona. We're located at Waterford on the east side and Winter Garden on the west side. And for everybody in between, we have our convenient downtown office. I've provided a list of links, numbers, locations, addresses on the right-hand side of the screen for any of you guys that are wanting to take a picture. The best thing is no appointment is necessary. So you're able to walk in and be seen same day as your injury. Or if you want to, you can always pre-register by going to the link that I have listed below. Or like Brandon said, through your FKK website. So what's the benefit? Well, you're able to see and have immediate orthopedic care by one of our specialized providers that specialize in orthopedics. Your athlete can be evaluated same day, receive treatment for any broken bones, muscle strains, foot, hip, knee, ankle, shoulder, or even concussion evaluation and treatment. At the walk-in clinics, after you check in and show your insurance, we're able to get you roomed by seeing one of our medical assistants. We're able to obtain x-rays same day, perform a thorough orthopedic physical exam. If needs be, we're capable of reducing fracture or dislocations, casting and splinting on site, prescribe medications, and if needs be, order MRIs or CT scan of your athlete. Our walk-in clinics are able to do this for a fraction of the cost and more efficiently than your local emergency rooms. And the best part is that if your athlete does require surgery, well, we have direct access to one of our 23 orthopedic surgeons that we can get them to in a timely manner. So when it comes to your athlete, I want to make sure that you guys understand Orlando Orthopaedic Center is there for you to keep you on the field and as safe as possible. So next time that you have an orthopedic injury, why don't you skip the ER and go right to an orthopedic specialist for fast and accurate diagnosis and treatment. I appreciate your guys' time and just know that we're there for you.
Thanks, Tom. Guys, just hang tight here. We're going to bring back Danny and then we're going to ask a few questions, but we'll get to interact with everybody at the same time. So Danny's going to talk to you a little bit about return to play. And then we'll bring everybody on, including Dax and Allie, who have joined us, which I'm very, very excited about. And we'll go ahead and ask a bunch of questions that we have here in the Q&A. And then I have some as well that I just thought of for some of our panelists. So go ahead. Why don't you take us home, Dan? Tom, if you can stop sharing screen.
Sweet. So obviously, I know I'm not as entertaining as Dax or Allie, so I'll make our return to play. I'll kind of get through it here. One of our easily our most complicated and our, I think, interesting group, we have a return to sport group that's kind of here at Spectrum. I kind of want to talk vaguely about just what return to play looks like. And obviously this is a partnership with an orthopedic, a partnership with a physical therapist. Our staff who run this group have to be very heavily involved. Obviously, we have to, we take all of their prognosis and their recommendations as seriously as possible. But essentially what we're looking to do, this is our individuals who have gone through some kind of injury. They have then gone and seen a proper athletic trainer, orthopedic, maybe they've gone through physical therapy, and now they're kind of ready to start reintroducing strength training and movement work outside of their physical therapist. However, the athlete's not quite ready to go right back full speed onto the field. And this is where we can come in. And whether we're involved with anyone, like, this is really important stuff that an athlete goes through before they get back on the field. So one of the, right off the jump, is rebuilding strength in the involved limb. Obviously, any athlete who sustains any kind of prolonged injury, isn't that we have to limit usage and load bearing on that injured limb while it's going through a recovery phase. And as a result, the muscles throughout that limb are going to atrophy, right? They're not being used. And so they're going to get smaller, they're going to get weaker. And so when an athlete comes out and there's a massive asymmetry between their right and left limbs, whether it's lower upper body, like, that's a high correlation to a re-injury. And that's obviously what we're trying to prevent here. Let's get our athletes ready to go, healthy as can be, then get them back on the field. And so, like I said, finding ways to rebuild strength in the involved leg while maintaining in the healthy leg or limb, whatever it might be. The other thing to keep in mind too is that non-involved leg, so the limb that did not suffer the injury, is going to take over and do a lot of the things while that athlete's going through that recovery phase and they can't use the other one. And so that only furthers that gap. And so, like I said, it's our job to reduce that gap. And whether it's something as simple as just doing higher volume on the involved leg, finding all different ways to, like I said, even that balance, because that's one of the biggest things we have to get rid of. We have to get an athlete back to using both legs, both arms equally, and no kind of gap, no kind of significant gap between muscular strength or muscular mass within the limb. The other thing then, we are reteaching basic movement mechanics. And I kind of talked about this in, you know, it's such a big part of our, like, just our preventative phase is making sure their mechanics are solid. Because like I said, if there's a problem in those mechanics, we think about our athletes, these soccer players are running miles throughout the week between practices and games, and they have so many repetitions of an activity that if they're doing it wrong, there's such a high chance of injury as a result from that. And so these athletes who are coming back, it's probably a safe assumption that there was some error in their mechanics. And even if there wasn't, we need to make sure that their mechanics haven't changed post injury because they got used to not using that limb the way they were prior. So everything they're going to do on the field, we need to break it down into smaller pieces. We need to teach it at low speeds, low intensities. And then gradually, once they start to show competency in those positions, we start building it back up. So for example, our soccer players are nonstop hard sprint, plant, change direction, go a different way, right? So teaching an athlete how to cut. Well, we need to first establish, how do we decelerate? Teaching an athlete to chop their feet, to start to lower their hips, as opposed to staying really high and just taking like a hard step into the ground and stopping all their weight. Because that's so much impact and force on whatever leg they're stomping into the ground. As we get lower to the ground, we start using a little bit more quads, glutes. As we chop our feet, we evenly distribute that impact amongst five or six steps compared to one or two. And so it's just less force on the body, right? So we have to teach that athlete how to break down, how to decelerate. We then have to teach them how to, when they go to cut, which leg they're pushing off of, which direction they're orienting their body, how to recreate force coming out of it. And so we teach, like I said, those individual parts. As an athlete builds competency, we then start putting those parts together. As that looks good, we then start adding speed to it, right? It's one thing they can do it at half speed, but we all know when they go back to play, it's full speed, full intensity. And so we got to see that they can do it in a higher intensity, higher speeds. And then once we feel that confidence, we've started to reduce the asymmetry between the two limbs. We feel really good and really strong about their movement mechanics. We start reintroducing game environments. That's the other thing. Like, no matter how good of a session we plan, like nothing simulates a game environment, right? And so we find ways in this building to make drills competitive, putting clocks on it, forcing our athletes to go at full speed the same way they're going to when they get back on the field. Because once an athlete gets into a competitive, into an instinctual mindset, do all those mechanics that we just spent all this time teaching, do they go out the window? Because they're just trying to, you know, get from A to B as fast as possible. They're not thinking about how to cut. And we know we have more work to do, and we have to start really digging in onto those patterns and changing, you know, their patterns when they go into cut or change reduction, whatever. Or do they show healthy, proper, optimal mechanics at full speeds, at competitive environments when they're not thinking about it? Because once we've gotten to that phase, now we know that an athlete's really ready to start going back on the field. Because we know that when they're in the game, not thinking about how they're decelerating, how they're cutting, we know they're going to do it right. And that's a home run to us. And that's when we're ready to really start, like I said, working that athlete back into play. And I can't stress enough how much of this is a team effort. We this group in our that's done in our facility is ran by two staff members. It's always a small group of individuals who are in it. So we're talking two coaches, a lot of times to two or three athletes. The one coach is one of the owners of the company, has been running the group for 10 plus years. The other member is a fully licensed PTA who has also been a strength coach for us. And they are constantly on the phone with physical therapists, with orthopedics. It's such a team effort that goes into getting an athlete back on the field. But these are essentially the steps that we take to start working that athlete back into, like I said, full speed, full play, because the ultimate thing is we got to make sure they're ready. We've built a strong foundation and we know they're going to be safe and they can trust that leg or that arm or whatever it is. They know they can trust their body and they can go full speed. And like I said, that's a home run for us. And so that's kind of our return to play protocol.
That's awesome, Danny. Thanks so much. And kind of perfect timing. That kind of brings things around full circle for Allie and Dax too. If you guys can all the panelists join in, at least turn on your video, and then Dax and Allie, if you're listening in, if you can unmute yourselves and turn on your videos if you're around. There's Dax. What's up, man? Allie, how are you?
Hi, good. How are you?
Thanks, guys, for joining. I appreciate you doing this. So why don't we do this? We do have some questions here. Why don't the two of you, for those that are listening and watching that aren't very familiar with, they should be familiar with you, but if they're not, why don't you do a quick introduction, if you guys don't mind.
Go ahead, Allie. Ladies first.
Oh, you're so kind. No, my name's Allie Long. I play professional soccer for Gotham FC in the same stadium where Dax played many, many of his years at Red Bull Arena, and played for the national team from 2015 until basically I got pregnant. Won the World Cup in 2019.
Well, it's tough to follow that up. I have not won a World Cup. I haven't been to a World Cup, so it's tough to follow up. But I'm Dax McCarty, and I am proudly born and raised in Winter Park, Florida, right down the street, hopefully, from a bunch of you guys on this call. I started my professional career in 2006. So I just completed my 17th professional season here in Nashville. Like Allie said, I played in New York for about 6 years at Red Bull Arena. I've played in Dallas, DC, New York, Chicago, and now Nashville. So quite the globetrotting US career, but I've enjoyed every city that I've been in. And I have been lucky enough to represent my national team as well, the men's national team, a handful of times in a tournament like the Gold Cup, not quite as prestigious as the World Cup, but I'll take it.
Like so. Your World Cup at that.
Yeah, exactly. So obviously it's a pleasure to be on the call and I'm looking forward to talking to you guys.
So that's awesome, guys. Again, thank you for your time. So just kind of cool, like from my perspective, and you guys can comment on this. I think FKK does a really amazing job providing a lot of resources at this youth club level, correct? I think all you guys kind of agree. And I think that's really, really important. And I guess to my first question directed toward Dax and Allie, and the question coming from Hugh as well, I mean, this is kind of a loaded question, I guess, but what have you guys done, or do you, if you can pinpoint one or two secrets or tips to having a long career, for what your longevity has been from your youth to now, can you give us a tip? We can talk about physically, mentally, all those type of things, but if you can kind of point out one or two things and tell our viewers.
Go ahead, Allie.
Okay, fine. Last one, then you're going first. No, I think that it's always just being proactive and knowing that your career is up to you just being healthy. At the top level, the margins are so small, and of the guy next to you and coming for your spot on the team. And I think just being proactive in all your recovery after practice, whether that's an ice bath. And I think that different people, it works, different recovery modalities work different for different people. For me, it's like an ice bath after practices and games. It is, you know, jumping the Normatex. It is, you know, paying a massage therapist to come and massage me. It's doing all the little details. And I think that when you invest in your body and you invest in doing the small things every day, it becomes a habit. And that's just something I think I started once I was balancing the national team and club soccer. The demand is so high that I just need to stay healthy. And I was available to make, you know, the roster for the World Cup or the Olympics, which was a dream of mine since I've been little. So just being proactive and, you know, finding what recovery works for you and continually like educating yourself on it and why it's important. And, you know, I'm not a biohacker, but like I would try pretty much anything if they told me I would feel better tomorrow, any type of thing.
Yeah, that's a great answer from Allie. Just to add to it, I mean, it sounds really cliche. I mean, I don't know how many players are on this call, but even for parents of players who are young and they might not be on this call. I mean, for me, talent is great. And no matter what sport you play, that's always obviously, you know, mildly important to have talent. But quite honestly, the best ability that you can have as an athlete is availability. And that's, it sounds cliche, it sounds simple, but quite honestly, you cannot hit the peaks of a career if you're never on the field or if you're constantly battling your own body. And so for me, when I was young, one of the best traits that I had that I offered was an ability to just run all day, was just to be super fit. But I was never what you would, right now, I mean, all these, you know, guys that run data and numbers are on here thinking like we have, you know, data on all these athletes, right? What's your top speed? How high can you jump? How fast can you do a shuttle test? All these different metrics that are used to measure athletes. And they didn't have this when I was growing up, and maybe Allie would agree with this. It was just all about your eye test and honestly, your ability to stay on the field, because if you can't be on the field, if you're not going to be on the field to prove how good you are, then I don't think you're ever going to be able to get the consistency to hit the heights of a career in professional sports that you may want to have. So what Allie talked about in terms of doing all the little things right, taking care of your body, something that really helped me in the middle of my career was prehab and doing prehab exercises in the gym and even at home every single day before training and after training. And so what does that mean? That means making sure that you're flexible. I was never flexible. I adopted yoga about halfway through my career and I started noticing little differences in how I felt in training every single day. And yoga was a big part of that. And a lot of that comes down to being flexible, making sure that, I believe it was Danny that talked about the ability to put strain on your muscles before training, after training, during training, so that when you're put in a match environment, that you know that your muscles can handle the load that a game requires. Because it's really difficult in training to recapture the intensity of a game. And it's on the athlete, it's on you as a player to make sure that you're doing everything you can to put your muscles through that strain so that when you do play in a game, you're used to it and your body can handle it. And so for me, it was yoga, it was prehab, it was doing all the little things in the gym before and after training that meant I was able to maximize my flexibility, maximize my core strength. And you know, luckily, knock on wood, I mean, I've had a few injuries here and there. I don't think any athlete will go through a long career without having any injuries whatsoever. But if you're able to minimize small, the adding up of small injuries, then that's going to prolong your career significantly.
Yeah. And to both of your points, myself as an athletic trainer in the collegiate level for a long time, I told my guys, it's really, really important. And, you know, sometimes we just worry about what the coaches are telling us, what's in our face right then and there, but then we don't take it home, right? We don't think about it. Yeah, you need to go home and you recover, but it's all the stuff off the field, off the soccer field, right? Those little things that you do or you take initiative in, whether it's getting your own massage, your own recovery, your own nutrition, doing all those little things or taking what Danny's telling you and applying that when you're away from all of it, right, is just as important, I would think. That's what I told my guys.
It's a good point. I mean, I didn't really hit on sleep and nutrition as much, but I think it's, especially nowadays, I mean, back when I was young and growing up, when you could run all day, I could eat a McDonald's breakfast and go train and have absolutely no issues whatsoever. And now, I just think it's different the way that sports medicine, and especially when it comes to nutrition, I think the data that we have, for athletes and especially how competitive of an environment professional sports is, anything you can do to get a leg up on your competition is going to be beneficial, right? So whether that's an extra hour of sleep or whether that's having a salad or a protein shake or a recovery shake, eating an energy bar before training, anything that you can do to maximize your ability to perform on the field is important. Like something that I've always done my entire career that has always helped me is when either post-training or before a game, if I have felt a little bit sluggish or tired, I've always taken a nap. And sometimes that some people may not always subscribe to that notion, but for me, it always led me to feel a little bit refreshed, a little bit more ready to train or play when I woke up from that. And, you know, there's all kinds of different methods out there and different methodologies, but you have to find what works for you and what works for your body, because something that I do isn't necessarily something that Ali would do and vice versa, right? Because everybody has their own body. Everybody has their own little issues that they're fighting. And so the quicker that you can determine what type of sleep, what type of nutrition, what type of prehab, what type of strength work that you need to maximize your facilities on the field and your overall performance on the field, do it as soon as possible.
Okay, let's do this. Let's get to I got a couple questions here in the Q&A. I think we touched on Hugh's question, their questions. What about, I have a question here, probably directed to both Brendan and Tom. What do you do for Achilles tendonitis in an 11-year-old?
Already?
Tom, maybe. Yeah, that's tough.
That's a tough one. Tom, let's start with you there.
So the first thing is 11-year-olds and Achilles tendonitis, you need to identify what's the cause, right? Is it a muscle imbalance? Is it an overuse? Is it shoe wear? Is it something else other than Achilles tendonitis, like Sievers disease, which is calcaneal apophysitis? If it is just truly a Achilles tendonitis, which could be self-limiting and possibly take your athlete out of competition for a little bit, simple treatment. It's go back to the basics, rest, ice, compression, elevation, over-the-counter analgesics as needed, incorporating a simple range of motion and stretching program is always going to be beneficial. But it's really going to be modifying your activities over a couple of weeks and then identifying the culprit. If the pain persists, despite utilizing that conservative management, definitely come in, get seen. Let's make sure that there's not like a calcaneal apophysitis that is the actual culprit of the symptom.
Tom, since I got you here too, what are some other common injuries that you see in a soccer athlete? I know you can see a lot of things, but what if you can pinpoint just a few things that you see the most in the clinic?
I would say the most that I see is going to be ankle sprains, peroneal tendon strains, a lot of ankle injuries. So that's where Spectrum is going to, really help your athlete to, increase that stability and the balance or proprioception of the ankle to kind of do that prehab type of treatment. Unfortunately, we do see ACL injuries where that's the anterior cruciate ligament that gets torn. And, you know, we have excellent physicians on our practice that are capable of treating not only your adolescent, but also your juveniles with this type of pathology.
This next question here really probably can be for quite for anybody, and even Dax and Allie, maybe from your expertise, and you kind of already talked about a little bit. You know, the question always comes up. It always comes up: ice versus heat, which is better? Can I mix the two? Then can I massage? Based on everybody's opinion, because I know you've all experienced it. What are your thoughts? Anybody can take it away.
Just from my perspective, to be completely honest, I've been on a few different teams with obviously multiple different training staffs and doctors, and it's kind of funny because there doesn't really seem to be any consensus as to, you know, what is the exact right way to handle heat versus cold and ice. Some trainers that I've had have been completely against ice in terms of, okay, it helps with swelling, but it doesn't really help with much else. You know, and you should be constantly heating your muscles up and trying to keep your muscles loose, and especially, you know, pre-training, post-training. And so for me, what I have found that has always worked with me is that I've done, I'm all about balance. And so I try to do a little bit of both, right? And sometimes it could just be, you know, something that you build up in your head as, oh, I took an ice bath before one game and I scored 3 goals. And so from now on, I'm going to take an ice bath before every game. And that's just something that works for you. And it works for your body. So for me, I've always done both. I've always tried to balance both. If I'm really sore, doing a contrast bath between cold and hot has been very beneficial in helping me feel a little bit better for the next day. You know, before I go to sleep, you know, sometimes I'll hop in the bath and just try to, you know, relax, use that to help my muscles loosen, relax. I'll wake up feeling better the next day. So there's all kinds of stuff you can do nowadays in terms of the hydrotherapy and the the cold chambers where these athletes are going and getting zapped for 3 minutes in negative 200 degree, you know, chambers. It's, you know, all that stuff is, I think, beneficial on a certain level. But again, like I said, you just have to find out what works for yourself.
To piggyback on what Dak said, I think it's very injury dependent on what's best for you at what time and what stage of the injury. Obviously, I think Dax hit it right on the head at the beginning. When you're in a lot of pain, ice is going to be beneficial. As you're getting better and warming up, think of your muscles like a rubber band. You know, if you put a rubber band in the freezer and try and stretch it, it's going to snap. So you never want to ice right before practice or something like that. You're going to set yourself up. But you want to warm up maybe through heat or maybe through a dynamic warm-up with Danny before. And that way your muscles are going to be ready for that kind of intense physical movement and exertion and hopefully prevent that injury from happening.
Yeah. And for me, I think that I always look at anything in recovery wise, whether it's inflammation, injury, I always look at it as I just want to create flow. I want to create like blood going in and out of wherever that injury site is, bring new blood in, healthy new blood back to that site, and just continue that process of flushing it out and in. And I think contrast is always, or I guess the past 5 years of my career, I think earlier on it was always like ice or heat, you know, before practice ice then. And I just think the contrast of constricting and kind of opening up, you know, for your blood to just interchange and as much contrast I can get, that's kind of my goal.
Tom, this is a question I have for you specifically. When you come to the clinic for an appointment, mm-hmm. I get this question sometimes from patient population. They ask, do I get an x-ray? Is that standard no matter what it is, or is it case by case basis depending on the anatomy of the injury, or when you get an appointment, do you usually typically get an x-ray to rule out?
I would say almost all the time we're going to get an x-ray to just rule out small hairline fractures. To, you know, the x-rays only look at bone, right? So osseous structures. So very rarely will we abstain from getting an x-ray. you know, I'm not saying, I'm not trying to scare anybody, but the x-rays also assess for tumors and cancer type of pathology that can mimic acute athletic injuries or heterotopic ossification. So, you know, it is beneficial to get an x-ray with limited radiation exposure, understanding, you know, that our staff are very well competent with guarding and protecting the athlete from any excessive radiation, for sure.
Okay. And we got a bunch of questions here that I want to get to, but I want to touch on something briefly to everybody watching. There is on that website that I put in the chat there and that Brendan was referring to, we do have a concussion protocol that we created that is pretty standard for the state of Florida. But we put that in that website there for, so, and we do evaluate concussions at Orlando Orthopaedic Center. Obviously it's a very common injury in soccer, as we know, but we don't need to go into the whole concussion talk and spiel, but if you guys do sustain a concussion, you have any questions, please feel free to use that website or let Brenda and myself know, and we can help get to the right person. We go ahead here and outside of practice and game stretching, what are some ideal off the field stretches to implement? Maybe Danny, if that's something you can chat on.
Yeah, I think one of the ones that a lot of the athletes probably can't stand, and hopefully they remember the name of it, we call it couch stretch. But like I said, some of our soccer players, a lot of overused quads and hip flexors. So something we can use to stretch the anterior portion of the leg, the hip quads. It's called a couch stretch because you can do it at home on your couch. You put your knee, you drop down on your knees, you put one knee up against the wall or up against the couch, and your foot goes up the wall with you. And then you kind of step out and put your other foot flat on the ground. And it's just basically a big stretch throughout the hip and the quad. Like I said, anything that's going to open up anterior portion of the hip, really valuable for these guys and gals.
Okay. And then follow up with you, what type of prehab / strength training do you recommend for the developmental ages, age 10? Says practices 4 times a week, 1.5 hours game, one to two a week. Do you have any type of prehab and strengthening you recommend for that developmental age group?
I think at that age, you know, and it mimics what we do in the facility. Like, we just need to do really basic things really well with really low weight and build volume. So at that age, you're not really changing muscle tissue a whole lot. You're just kind of changing the way the brain interacts with the muscle tissue. You're changing neural patterns. So athletes should get really good at squatting and lunging and using their core, not just, you know, resting on their spine, like actually bracing their stomach. They should get really good at activating their glutes, things like mini band walks, or like we'll put a mini band, resistance band around an athlete's knees and have them just do squats with it. They're not holding any weight. They just have the band around their knees. Builds quads, it teaches an athlete how to use their glutes, things like planks, anything, depending on what the athlete home has, or falling hamstrings or Nordic leg curls, where one athlete holds another athlete's ankles down and the working athlete is on his knees and he falls slowly forward. It builds up the hamstrings. Any kind of glute bridging, push-ups, any body weight exercises are going to be really valuable. Like I said, we're not trying to load them up, because athletes who haven't gone through puberty yet aren't seeing any change in muscle tissue. We're just trying to make the brain more efficient at talking to the muscles. And that will set them up when they are much older and their muscles are ready for change and things like that, because they'll have really solid patterns and foundations.
If I could say, just to add on to what Danny said, I wasn't sure, honestly, if Nordics were age appropriate that young, but just a quick story about something that happened to me in my career. I had never had a muscular injury in my entire career up until about 5-6 years ago. And it was a hamstring injury, and I hurt my hamstring, just a small strain. I was only out for 3 or 4 weeks, did all my rehab, got back, played about three or more, four games. And then I hurt it again. And so I re-injured it. And at that point, it was at that point that I said, I need to do something differently. And my athletic trainer suggested Nordics, not just for rehab, but as to add to my prehab routine in terms of once or twice a week, do at least two sets of four Nordics to make sure that you're keeping your hamstring strong. So for me as a soccer player, your hamstrings are, I mean, obviously every part of your body is important, but your hamstrings are, for me, one of the most important things that you can work on and build up muscular strength, because when you have to sprint, that's going to be the muscle that's firing the most. And for me as a professional soccer player, the injury that I see more than any in terms of a pure muscular injury is a hamstring injury. And I think it's because people kind of take it for granted a little bit. It's not necessarily something that you think about to try to build the muscle up. It's more of, oh, glutes and hips and, you know, core and all that stuff. So for me, what Danny said about Nordics, if someone's holding your ankles and you're on your knees and you just fall forward, try to be as strong as you can, do it as slow as you can. That has helped me. I haven't had, knock on wood, haven't had another hamstring injury since. And that's something that I have found to be extremely beneficial to longevity and just making sure that you stay on the field, especially as you get older. I mean, I don't think anyone on this chat is going to have to worry about that at this point in their life or career, but I promise you that Nordics as a prehab exercise will make your hamstrings very strong.
Hey, Tom, if you're listening, what's your, and again, I know this is case by case, but what's your return to play or your timeout when you have a significant hamstring strain?
I think like Dax was indicating, even though that he's a professional athlete, which are known notoriously to recover a lot quicker, but your standard is about 3 to 4 weeks, depending on the severity and location, right? Is it proximal? Is it in the muscle belly? Is it distal? And that all comes to play to figure out the longevity of the pathology.
Thanks. Danny, coming back to you real quick. We have a question here about trying to find out details about spectrum sessions. I don't know, without going into all that, I don't know if you can type your website into the chat or type some information in there where they can find out a little bit about spectrum in the sessions.
Yeah, absolutely. I'll go ahead and type in the chat with spectrumsp.com. You can go to our website. Our spectrumsp is also our Instagram handle. It kind of gives you a insight into, you know, what it looks like in the building just on an everyday basis.
So we're getting here close to the end. We're a little bit over, but I kind of had a question. It's a little not injury related, but I guess to Dax and Allie, if she's on board, this is for my own personal, curiosity. When you guys, we have a lot of viewers that are youth rec, high school, age, where colleges are starting to look at them outside of skill level and talent, right? You know, outside of that, what are colleges, when you're being evaluated, is there anything specific you think or coaches told you at the collegiate level that were looking at you? What are they looking for, I guess, is my question. Outside of talent, or is that it? Is there anything else?
You want me to take this one, Allie? You got it?
I was going to highlight you. And then lead you into answering it, because if you've ever watched Dax, like he said earlier, he's gonna run everywhere. He covers so much ground. One of the hardest workers on the field. That's something I've always noticed about him right away. So then I wanted Dax to go into answering.
Oh, thank you. I really appreciate it. Allie.
She's busy. Allie's like, busy right now.
Yeah, clearly. I've got my wife luckily taking care of all the ones. But no, I think other than skill level, talent, I think what Allie said is very important. You can control, there's a lot of things as an athlete that you can't control. Sometimes you can't control injuries. You know, some of it is luck. You can get unlucky with injuries. You can control how you try to prevent injuries, but sometimes at the end of the day, you just get unlucky in a tackle and something happens. And so for me, you can control your attitude, how you approach rehab. You can control how hard you work off the field and on the field. There's been plenty of times where I've been stinking it up on the field and been having a bad game, but I've also told myself that in order to make up for it, I need to be the hardest worker on the field, because soccer is such a great sport in that you can do so many little things to be able to make up for maybe a bad pass or, you know, you miss a goal, right? You can do other things to help your team. And for me, I mean, when you're talking to coaches and coaches are trying to get to know you, I think the best thing that you can do is be authentic, be yourself, but be a good person. College coaches are looking not just for great players, but they're looking for great people. They want people who are well-rounded. They want people who are respectful, and they want people who are above all else looking to play for the team name on the crest, on the front of the jersey. They're not looking for people who only care about statistics and how many goals can I score? How many assists can I get? You know, one thing that I've learned being on a lot of different teams and a lot of different locker rooms, usually the most valuable players are the players that are willing to sacrifice for the team, the players that are willing to play multiple positions, the players that are not going to complain when maybe they aren't playing as much as they should, the players that are going to keep their head down and work hard and not be all about the person in the mirror, right? Not be selfish, not be a person that just cares about what's happening with them. They're players that are unselfish, and they're players that just want the team to succeed, because ultimately soccer is a team sport. If you want to be in a sport where it's all about you, I recommend playing tennis or golf or, you know, something that, you know, you'll get all the accolades and all the glory. Because ultimately, if I've learned anything, it's kind of like Ali in the World Cup when they won the World Cup in 2019. There were a lot of great players on that team. There were a lot of great personalities, but ultimately everyone's going to remember how great of a team that was, and how they all fought and came together and supported each other. And that's how you become legendary. That's how you get remembered, is being a great teammate and being a part of a team that's successful. Because if you have a great season and you're a great player and you score 20 goals, you know, people will talk about it for a couple of weeks. And then if your team loses because you weren't willing to sacrifice and put in the work, then no one's going to remember you. So for me, it's all about being a good teammate. It's about being a good person. It's about understanding that not everyone comes from the same walk of life as you. Be empathetic to other people's situations. And I think college coaches and coaches in the future will really appreciate that.
That's kind of a great way to end. Anybody, before we kind of send everybody off here, anybody else have any takeaway points or anything else they'd like to discuss? I say to all the viewers, if continue your path to soccer, don't get into the medical field, because if you get into medicine, you can see what will happen with your foreheads, with myself and Tom. anything else? There's some other questions here, but some of them we've kind of already touched. We are recording this, so if anybody wants to watch this again, we'll make sure that we get it to everybody over at FKK, to get out to all the families. And then I also just want to say one more time that for all those that were watching today, the Orlando Orthopaedic Center Foundation is going to donate three $250 scholarships to randomly selected members here by the administrators and the directors here at the completion of this. So I want to thank you guys very much. Danny, that was awesome. Brendan, thank you so much. Tom, as always, thank you. Dax and Ali, was an absolute pleasure. It was a pleasure to meet you guys, and we appreciate your expertise and taking the time out of your day to hang out with us.
Thanks for having us, guys.
Thanks so much.
Thanks, Dax.
Bye, guys. Bye, Hugh.
Thank you, guys. Have a great day.
Thanks for watching. Hugh, hopefully we did okay.
Stay safe, play hard.
I don't want Hugh to call me and get mad that I did messed up. Thanks, everybody. We'll see you again soon. Signing off. We're leaving.